Welcome to our continuing series, Explorations in Savitri, with our brother Alok. We are continuing on the last canto of Book 2, the Book of the Traveler of the Worlds, Canto 15, The Kingdoms of the Greater Knowledge. And we're on page 299, about 10 lines from the bottom.
So, as we were just sharing this, essentially the difference between the greater knowledge and what we normally call as knowledge is that greater knowledge is based on the conscious awareness of the one and the oneness. So it knows how the one is expressing through the play of forces, and it knows the right law of each thing and its fulfillment, because it's always conscious of the one and the oneness. Whereas the lesser knowledge or the little knowledge, or as the Mundaka Upanishad would put it, that there is the lesser knowledge and the higher knowledge. That's how it puts it. So that's where we forget the one and the oneness, and we have something called as a practicable knowledge. It's also knowledge, but it doesn't give us, it's like, you know, you can know about the car by knowing each part of it, technically. But still, there are things you don't know. Who is the driver? Where can the car go? What uses it can be put to? All these is an important aspect of the knowledge. So similarly, we are now into greater knowledge, which is, Aurobindo is beginning to enter there, Ashwapati, which is basically a knowledge based completely on the vision of the one and how the one is expressing himself through countless bodies and vessels. And there is also the oneness of forces. And the typical example is that when people ask the difference between human love and divine love, there is only one love. There is no two love. When you know the one, you will know that there is only one love. So what happens in human love, it becomes mixed up with, like the same Ganga water from Gomukh becomes mixed with all the pollution from, you know, the lesser worlds. They have their own law. So it becomes mixed with desires, ego and expectation. The more it gets mixed, the more it seems to deviate away from the true source. And the more you can purify and refine it, you can get back to the same original thing. So that is everywhere. So same with truth. Everywhere there is truth, which is hidden inside. But it gets mixed with opinions, partial viewpoints, angles of looking at it. And therefore we lose the truth. That's why when we define truth from this level, we have to say truth is a totality. But if you live in that consciousness, you say truth is a self-existent reality. It's, you don't have to be. By its very nature, it sees the totality. So that's how. And we continue further. After the triple fire, so basically Ashwapati has become among the, if you may use the word, priest of the cosmic sacrifice. So he becomes one among those who are conducting the cosmic sacrifice, meaning thereby they are recipients of all that happens in creation, and they purify it, serve the sessions of the triple fire and return it back into creation. That is the cosmic sacrifice. On the rim of two continents of slumber and trance. So slumber, this state of ignorance, and trance, where there is the sushupti, where the human mind, it cannot enter and remain conscious. So he stands on the borderline, which joins the lower and the higher hemisphere, the aparardh and the parardh. So he is standing on the rim. He heard the ever unspoken reality's voice, awaken revelation's mystic cry. So what is this voice which is unspoken? So normally when you produce a sound, you need to strike something against something. It can be two waves. But this is the unstruck sound. It's not spoken and yet it is a voice. So this is the voice that started the world's rolling. So it is the voice which went into creation, the creative word. So this is the unspoken voice. So here he is using the word unspoken reality's voice. Awaken revelation's mystic cry. When we are privy to that voice, to that vibration, originally the sense of the word, then we too share that revelation of truth. the birthplace found of the sudden infallible word and lived in the rays of an intuitive sun. This is what we were referring to, the infallible word. This Om. Is the original.
For me, it's Om.
Yes, yes. So it is the birthplace found. That's where the first stir of creation began. And you see, the reason why I'm saying it's only the last two pages where you see actually he's entering into the supermind is that here he's mentioning still the rays of the intuitive sun.
Mm.
He is not yet living in the full orb of the supramental sun. Though he's receiving everything there, and if we read the description of the highest layers of the overmind in the life divine, we'll see a correspondence. So there is truth, there is no ignorance in the highest realm of the overmind where it joins the supramental. There is no ignorance there, but there is the possibility of ignorance. Because, you know, it's still the ray and not the sun. Absolved from the ligaments of death and sleep. This is the pash, the bonds of ignorance or the bands of ignorance, the ligaments, which hold creatures in its grip right from the mind worlds downwards. He rode the lightning seas of cosmic mind and crossed the ocean of original sound on the last step to the supernal birth. So lightning seas, the other day someone was speaking about electrical or Vedvat Agni. So that's where knowledge is like sudden flashes of revelations, burst of knowledge, which shows you large spaces of time. That's how knowledge works there. And he's using the word revelation, lightning, seas. So constantly whatever needs to be seen is seen in sudden outburst of truth sight. And we have the supernal birth. So birth here is not about, we think birth is a birth in a human body. But birth in the original sense of the Upanishads is self-limitation. So creation is a birth by its very nature. Because the infinite limits himself. So that is the supernal birth. He trod along extinction's narrow edge. Because if you go beyond, there is no more the multiplicity. So you can dissolve. That's why in one of the messages, Mother says something to this effect that our task is not to annul ourselves, but to make life perfect with the divine perfection. So if you cross over this border, you can no longer remain conscious as an individual. You merge with that. That Ashupati will achieve the impossible is there in the next book. But near the high verges of eternity and mounted the gold ridge of the world dream, between the slayer and the saviour fire. So again we see the same, the rim of the overmind. Slayer and the saviour fires. So why does this flower fire slay below? The same fire. It slays because whatever is limited it has to break. That is how it becomes Yama. Surya becomes Yama in this domain. What does Yama do actually? Whatever is limited, even if it be the gods, high gods, still it can overpower because it breaks wherever there is a limit. So it's a slayer fire. It's not yet pure. But there, the fire that saves, it puts everything back to its original shape. The Vedic Rishi called it that which makes the crooked straight. So it is a savior fire. How does it save? By putting on track everything which has got distorted. So it's a savior. It doesn't destroy. It transforms. At one place, Mother uses the word, she says, love is the transforming power. So, she gives the difference between the power of purification and the power of love. She says, power of purification has to destroy in order to rebuild. But love does not do that. Love keeps on softening it. Like, you know, softening a rock by putting a leaven into it. And when the substance has become malleable enough, then it changes it without destroying it. And actually in this yoga, if one sees the process over long years of patient walking the path, you will see it works like that. You will wonder that how I had parts in me which I couldn't imagine. And they are softened, made more and more open and receptive. And then there is the change. It's not like a destruction. So it's a savior and a transforming fire. The belt he reached of the unchanging truth. So see, this is the belt. So all this description is of that joining line. Met borders of the inexpressible light and thrilled with the presence of the ineffable. So he is beginning to sense that. Above him, he saw the flaming hierarchies, the wings that fold around created space, the sun-eyed guardians and the golden sphinx. So sun-eyed guardians are, of course, in the Vedas, you have these four great gods, Varuna, Mitra, Bhaga and Ariman. These are the four great gods. And of course, in our yoga, we have the corresponding powers. Maheshwari, Mahakali, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswatis. They are the guardians. Guardians in the sense, they won't allow you to pass through that unless they have done their work. That's how Shubindo describes in the mother. When all the four powers have worked in you and molded you, then you are moved by the supramental Mahashakti, not before that. Until then, they will not allow, because otherwise the being will blow off. So that's why we see such a long labor. Each power will work. When one work is done, then the second one, then third one. Especially when Mahasaraswati works. It's a never-ending work. Because she is patient. She will not allow any smallest imperfection. She will say, no, not yet. Go through it. Till finally perfection is molded. So these are the sun, the guardians of the sun and the golden sphinx. He guards the gate of eternity. That's how Shubindu is described. She's of course who else but the supramental Mahashakti. She guards the gates of eternity. So only when she allows you, she sees you are ready. Now the best part is when supramental Mahashakti becomes the avatar or something of that is embodied. Avatar is Divine Mother herself. So then what happens? The mother describes it, that in the supramental ship she takes all of us. And then how do they judge? There are beings there who decide whether you can pass through or not. So she says that I laughed when I had that experience. I got up and I was laughing. So the disciple asks, why were you laughing, mother? She says, none of the ordinary criteria we think are important had any importance there. It was just the stuff of consciousness. They were just seeing and they were patches of orange or dark and based on that they knew. So she asked, what do you mean things which we consider very important? So she says, for example, all this ascetic idea of life that has no importance there. Particularly that you have to do this, you have to fast, you have to wake up in the morning, early morning like this. Then see, it has no idea, no significance. Then all the moral values. And then she says, for example, the sanctity of marriage and things like that. Mother's words. She says, all this is no criteria there. What is seen there is just the stuff of consciousness. Now, obviously, human beings are far from ready. Because that knowledge is so vast, so measureless, that's why human mind can completely lose its balance.
Mother has recorded this.
Yes.
So you can listen to it.
Is there in the agenda? It's also there in collected works. So it's part of the, it's not some idea. So that is how they see. And the tired plains and the immutable lords. They are not subject to any dissolution, the immutable lords. So in Indian yoga tradition, we have this pralaya and mahapralaya. So pralaya is what affects the terrestrial consciousness. And Mahapralaya is even up to the overmind, or let's say not the highest range, but even the gods are dissolved. They are absorbed back into the one. But there are realms which are not subject to Pralaya or Mahapralaya. Though the beings and gods of that realm forever exist. One of them being Krishna Lok in Vrindavan. So that cannot be dissolved. So it is not subject to Pralaya or Mahapralaya. So they are the immutable lords. A wisdom waiting on omniscience sat voiceless in a vast passivity. It judged not, measured not, nor strove to know, but listened for the veiled all-seeing thought and the burden of a calm, transcendent voice. So often this would happen with mother. And once that classic example of someone who there was a fight and the matter went to mother, and mother asked one sadhak to leave and go. So he said, but I have not done anything wrong. Actually, he's the person who has done wrong. Why am I being asked? So he went and asked Nalnida, and Nalnida said, if mother says something, take it as grace. She knows what is best for you. And he said, okay. After 10 years, he says, it was indeed a grace. It changed my life. So she was not saying based on judgment or condemning somebody or punishing someone. This is how our human mind will think. Even her rejections are not rejections, but postponements. That is how Maheshwari works. It's based on a much deeper truth than one can imagine. Amalkiran describes one instance where he was sitting against the mother's car, standing with his one of the foot resting on the car, and he got a slap. What? What did I do? When you are on the battlefield, can you afford to be unconscious? Another person was Kesha Bhai. He used to sleep on bricks and all, extremely ascetic person. He got a nice slap for no, apparently no fault of his. But he understood this Mahakali's prasad. We cannot.
I had a friend who, he was with another fellow, and that fellow stole something. Mother caught it. She called them both up. She said to my friend, if ever I catch you doing that again, I'll have to ask you to leave. He didn't take anything. It was the other boy.
And it's number of stories. And yes. As a child, we have heard such stories of Hazrat Musa and all this. And you know, they would always say, when these great mystics, they would say that you can accompany me, but don't ask me a single question about my deeds. You know, these beings live in a different plane. That's why Ganga, when she says, okay, I'll marry you, don't ask me what I am doing and why I am doing. Because they act from a very different consciousness. So the fact that now in this instance, when you have not taken anything, but you are observing and complaining and probably being self-righteous, I'm just, you know, that is far worse than probably, you know, doing these petty things and going to mother, I have done a mistake. I am a little man. So her ways are very different from the way we understand. So this is what we are, you know, wisdom that just not measured, not nor strove to know. But all of them are compassion. But listen to the veil, but listen for the veiled all-seeing thought and the burden of a calm, transcendent voice. He had reached the top of all that can be known. His sight surpassed creation's head and base. Ablaze the triple heavens, revealed their suns. The obscure abyss exposed its monstrous rule. Now, this triple heavens here, in all likelihood, they are the heavens of the Vedas. That's why sometimes good to, you know, have that background in Sri Aurobindo's light. So, Sri Aurobindo speaks of these heavens, which are the heavens of the intuitive, illumined, and the revelatory mind. It is about these heavens, not the heavens of the physical, vital, and mental world. So these triple heavens suddenly revealed their whole working and their lords. They were all right in front of him. As well as the abyss. All but the ultimate mystery was his field. Almost the unknowable disclosed its rim. So that's why again, it's not yet the supramental entry. In supermind, there is nothing which can remain unknowable. His self's infinities began to emerge. The hidden universes cried to him. Each part in us desires its absolute. So every finite part within us, even the smallest, has its own infinite truth behind it. That begins to reveal itself. And the mother knows it. That's why, you know, when she speaks of that man who was pasting the stamps beautifully on the covers. And she said, he's very useful for my work. Somebody said, he's useless. Said, no, he's pasting stamps so beautifully. Have you seen it? Self's infinities. So the spirit of order expressing itself in this way. Eternities called to eternities. All the great beings, the powers that are forever eternal, they cried within him, sending their speechless message still remote. Arisen from the marvel of the depths and burning from the superconscient heights and sweeping in great horizontal gyres, a million energy joined and we are the one. So this is the door where all the thousand forces of, as it is said, of the sun, they come together and are held and they enter into the one. Million energies, the Sahasrar. This is beyond the Sahasrar is the supramental. So Sahasrar is where you see the thousand petal lotus. And beyond it, if you go, that's the supramental realm. All flowed immeasurably to one sea. That's where the oneness is beginning to emerge. All living forms became its atom homes. Even the electron is the atom home of the omniscient and the omnipresent. It is everywhere. A panergy that harmonized all life because it's one consciousness, one power. So the moment it makes an action, everything else shifts accordingly. So it's always ultimately creating a leading towards harmony. Held now existence in its vast control, a portion of that majesty he was made, at will he lived in the unoblivious ray. So this is where, you know, he becomes part and parcel of the supramental Mahashakti, possibly soon after the Alipur jail experience, because the Alipur jail experience is the experience of supramental oneness. And after that, when Sri Aurobindo's wife went to ask some Swamiji in Ramakrishna Mission, I'm forgetting his name, and she asked him, she was worried about, concerned about Sri Aurobindo. He says, he's no more your Auro. The Divine Mother has taken him into her arms. So he is, you don't have to worry about him. The Divine Mother has taken him into her arms. So that must have been the experience as early as that. After coming here, he started rising into the supramental realms, which he writes in a letter to Bahrain. In that high realm where no untruth can come, where all are different and all is one, in the impersonal's ocean without shore, the person in the world spirit anchored road. So this is where there is an impersonal universality, the personality of such a person being, and we have the complete synthesis of the impersonal and the personal side of the one reality. If you reach the highest apex of our mind, a work which Sri Ramakrishna had come to do. That's how he could show the synthesis of all religions. And he's, as far as I know, he's the first one who speaks in more modern mystic literature that Nirgun and Sagun are two sides of one reality. He gave a very nice example. He said, you take a stick, his way of explaining. You take from this side to that side, you don't see an idol, you pass it through. This is Nirgun Brahman. Put from other side, you will touch the idol. But they are one reality. Before that, you will see that either they are leaning, even great mystics, like even Kabir, leaning either towards impersonal or they are leaning towards personal, like the many Bhakti Marg, you know, Ramanuj and all these beings. But Sri Ramakrishna created that synthesis. And that's why he prepared for the advent of Sri Aurobindo and the supramental age. That's the great contribution. It thrilled with the mighty marchings of world force. Its acts were the comrades of God's infinite peace. Now this description is very clearly now the first touches of the supramental, first touches is beginning to experience. So all the actions, Shubhinda at one place describes how all the opposites fuse. One of them is, he describes in Savitri, Amal Kiran's favorite line, one of the favorite lines. When people asked him, which is your favorite line? One of the lines he will say is, force one with unimaginable rest. Your actions are welling from infinite peace. Yes. There is no more that, oh, action, then rest. That's how we work. But force, but Mother and Shobindu in their life were living examples of this supramental creation. They would not sleep, they would continue to work. And in one of the places, Shobindu writes, if nothing else, if you just see this Herculean labor, half jokingly, half in a revealing way, that from night till morning I am replying to all the letters, you will understand that this is nothing else but an avatar. Who else can do it? In the history of mystic literature, you don't find it. I don't know of any yogi actually. Their mythological stories like Lakshmana had conquered sleep or Hanuman had conquered sleep, but they were graces granted to them because of a special kind of work. Otherwise, you don't find it. His mother and Sri Aurobindo, sleeplessly, just like the divine, sleeplessly, day and night, getting calls all the time. You know, famous story of Bulada. He had access to mother all the time. And at night, 2 o'clock, somebody knocked at his window. Bula, please tell mother, because he could go any time, that so-and-so relative has died. He said, okay. So he thought he has access, so he will convey. But Bulada saw mother's light is off now. So he went to Samadhi, told and went off to sleep. Next day when the person saw him while entering the ashram, did you tell mother? Yes, yes, I told at the Samadhi. Then he got very annoyed. Why didn't you tell mother? Now, when this family goes to mother, mother says, yes, yes, I am aware. Bulla told me yesterday. Sleepless vigil. Day and night. How they are watching over us. An adjunct glory and a symbol self, the body was delivered to the soul. Now it was no more moved by any other forces, but purely by the soul powers. That's how the body was delivered to the soul. It became a pure and perfect instrument of the soul. An immortal point of power, a block of poise, in a cosmicity's wide formless surge, a conscious edge of the transcendent's might, carving perfection from a bright world stuff, it figured in it a universe's sense. So all the triplicity, the triple poises of the divine, the individual, he uses the word point of power, the cosmic and the transcendent, we are fused together in a single and yet manifold realization in the being of Ashwapati. He had become literally the million-bodied one. And mother speaks of it, that how much he is working after the physical withdrawal. He says he is here, there, so many places at the same time. Because that is the inner truth. But people only see the physical body. There, consciousness was a close and single weft. The far and near were one in spirit space. The moments there were pregnant with all time. The superconscient screen was ripped by thought. So ultimately this lid is gone, ripped by thought. The intensity of this thought climbing all the way up, that aspiration mounting, ultimately the screen was ripped off. Look at this power of this line, word. Idea rotated symphonies of sight. So it's like something which is seeing all around at the same time. That's why one of the creatures which is regarded as a very spiritual being, though he is often, you know, looked down upon, is the Indian owl. You know what is the beauty of owl? It can move its neck 360 degrees. Nalini Da was very fond of owl. If you go to his room, you will see different types of owls. But in India, we call it owl, as if he is full. But owl is a compliment. Next time, you know, we should say thank you. Yeah, it's the bird of wisdom. So ideas rotated symphony of sight. So it can see all around and integrate it together. In a single sweep of vision. It's like you are having eyes all over. And mother literally, and Sri Aurobindo speaks even in evening talks. When mother told someone, I am seeing what you are doing behind. And then this was asked to Sri Aurobindo, can mother see behind? She says, yes, she has eyes all over. And this is when she is in physical body. She has eyes all over.
Yes.
So this, because already, you know, supramental reality was expressing through our body. Sight was a flamethrower from identity. What are you seeing? Yourself. So you can put yourself a little far, closer, but it's always yourself. It's the simplest example is, I can keep my hand very close to my eyes. And I can take my hand further and further away. But still it's my hand. It is never away from me. So that's how it is. The far and the near. It was just a matter of choice, but not a reality. Not an ultimate truth. Sight was a flamethrower from identity. Life was a marvelous journey of the spirit, feeling a wave from the universal bliss. So this again, you know, this flamethrower from identity is that however close or far my hand may be, it's still my hand. And I would care for it the same. So when people think that somebody who is working in mother's womb is closer to mother, shows that one understands neither spiritual truth. This one doesn't have to be supramental to understand it. Even our scriptures speak of this. We don't know who is close and who is far. All are her children. Somebody millions of miles away who remembers her is as close as somebody every day sweeping in her room. So we can put a veil between us and her. But from her point of view, all are her children, like the five fingers. In the kingdom of the spirit's power and light, as if one who arrived out of infinity's womb, he came newborn, infant and nibitless. This is the resurrection. Now he is newborn to the supramental, something that has never happened. And he is infant because it's a new consciousness, never experienced on earth. And he is limitless because it's the supramental consciousness. Infant and limitless. This child is capable of, you know, destroying or creating all the worlds with a breath. This is an infant, the divine infant. And grew in the wisdom of the timeless child. He was a vast that soon became a sun. A great luminous silence whispered to his heart. His knowledge and in-view caught unfathomable, an out-view by no brief horizons cut. He thought and felt in all. His gaze had power. If you want to understand what is meant by gaze had power, read Amrit Das's first darshan of Sri Aurobindo. It can shake you. You know, he goes and he has been told and he is asked to wait and he is waiting all the time. And then he is told, you know, just go there and take a little parikrama and come back. No conversation otherwise. So he goes and when he stands in front, he describes there like two balls of fire. What he saw. As if in the darkness, suddenly he saw two balls of fire that were lighting in front of him. And he forgot everything, lost everything. Until somebody told him, move. Like in the move. Suddenly he moved, dazed all around. Some of these darshans are amazing, you know.
It happened to Temi.
Yes.
She just went blank.
Yes. That's why children were not allowed. And people with psychological disturbance, people had to stay 10 feet away. Just to, you know, have the glimpse of Sri Aurobindo, a few seconds. I don't know of this kind of phenomena. I have read life of so many saints. But this kind of an effect a single gaze can hold. It's amazing. And we take it all for granted because, you know, we just, it is our Sri Aurobindo. So we take him for granted. He communed with the incommunicable. Even mother's gaze. They would describe when she looked at you suddenly, it looked like she is stripping you bare and seeing everything inside. You can't hide anything. That was the impression. Sometimes she would do a little surgery inside.
Most of us ended in tears.
Yes, of course. That of course. He communed with the incommunicable. beings of a wider consciousness were his friends. Forms of a larger, subtler make drew near. The gods conversed with him behind life's veil. Beings of a wider consciousness. That's how, you know, mother sent the Ashwins when Prithvi Singh Nahar had a, what we call as heart attack. And he suddenly saw the Ashwins. He didn't recognize their Ashwins. Two tall twins coming, entering the heart, giving some massage and applying some herbs from some world. And he recovered. So he asked the mother next day, did you send the, who were they? She said, well, because you cried, I sent the Ashwins. They normally don't go. They are physicians of the gods. It's not becoming for them, you know, to go and treat human beings. Friends. So she could do that. Neighbor, his being grew to nature's crests. The primal energy took him in its arms. His brain was wrapped in overwhelming light. And all embracing knowledge seized his heart. Thoughts rose in him no earthly mind can hold. This we know. That's why life divine. Yet we should read it, because they are thoughts which come from a different plane. No earthly mind could hold. So Amrita describes how in the early years he would read from the Arya aloud. So one day he is reading the chapter on life divine, reading again and again the same. Means life divine had not come out as a book, but he is reading that portion from the life divine in the Arya. And he's reading it mechanically. So Sri Aurobindo suddenly realizes Sri Aurobindo is standing and staring at him. So he smiles and says, so? He smiles and he says, yes, I'm reading Life Divine, but I can't understand anything. So Sri Aurobindo says, doesn't matter, you read it, even if you understand nothing at all. Sri Aurobindo's words, you read it.
Mother says it about Savitri.
Even if you understand nothing at all, read it.
Yes.
Imagine that sight, young Amrita, 16, 17, studying in Kalve College and, you know, reading Life Divine, and suddenly sees Sri Aurobindo is standing there. What these beings were. These beings were. Mites played that never course through mortal nerves. The only avatar I know who participated in a near world war, Mahabharata, is Shri Krishna, and before that Lord Rama in another scale. Here is an avatar who participated in the world war. Can we imagine? The whole world, and you know, they were the ones who were holding the reins of this war. Mites played. Where have we heard these? I can tell you, having read all the stories in every possible mythology, all know, but almost all. And nowhere you find this kind of a manifestation of divinity ever anywhere. He scanned the secrets of the overmind. He bore the rapture of the oversoul. His individual soul has become one with the cosmic. So it becomes an oversoul. A borderer of the empire of the sun. So that's where he stands. Now he is experiencing all that sun blaze and he will enter. A borderer of the empire of the sun. Attuned to the supernal harmonies, he linked creation to the eternal sphere. His finite parts approached their absolutes. His actions framed the movements of the gods. Reminds me of another line in Savitri. His actions left the footprints of a god. God. Everything that Sri Aurobindo and the mother have done has become like a new mold for the future. And I see this, today may not be the day to speak about it, but every action that they did has become a mold which centuries will express. One of the things which we clearly see is the coming together of mother and Sri Aurobindo, which is coming together of the best and east. In coming worldly life, you cannot remain an isolated being. These two sides have to come together. They have shown it in their own life. It's become a norm, the new norm. So many things that they have done will become the yardstick of the future, standard, new standards of thought and action. His finite parts approach their absolutes. His actions frame the movements of the gods. His will took up the reins of cosmic force. This is where this one line which reveals that now the avatar, the supramental avatar, is fully there in him. When Parshuram meets Rama and gives him his axe, he says, now it is your world, you continue. Or when Krishna on the battlefield, there you see the avatar holding the reins of the horse or holding the reins of the earthly play. So this is when Sri Aurobindo, in this my understanding or revelation on it, that just as he is reaching Pondicherry, he has become aware that his life, he is the avatar who is to change the direction of creation and the play of time. So he is given the reins of the cosmic force. And this reign is fully, ultimately handed over by Krishna on 24th November. It's your show now. Your baby. And your babies. Look after them. And he holds the will. His will took up the reins of cosmic force. So we'll...
End of Canto 15. End of Book 2. Book 3 will begin in August.
Oh, wow. When that's I return. Wonderful. Wonderful.
And we will have 7.5 months continuous.
Wonderful. Book of the Divine Mother.